So welcome to, well, in effect, the third day of this conference, the final day of this Tri-Ratna Earth Sangha conference. And this morning, I'm introducing Lokabandhu's second carbon sadhana, which is on the theme of flying. Now, I guess some of you would have been here yesterday on Friday evening for the first one. So in the second of his pre-recorded sessions, Lokabandhu asks, what really are the consequences of our actions? So this is a deep question indeed. And this meditation, modeled on classic Buddhist visualization practice, will help us to become vividly and graphically aware of the environmental consequences of flying. So, just want to say something about Lokabandhu. Lokabandhu was ordained in 1990, and he was a founder member of Butterfield, and he's currently a Green Town Councillor and Deputy Mayor in Glastonbury in Somerset in the UK. And as I mentioned, I think it was on Friday evening, I heard a rumour that he's going to be the Mayor of Glastonbury. I didn't know there was a mayor of Glastonbury, but he's going to be a mayor of Glastonbury next year. And I checked this out with him. I said, is this true, Lokabandhu? And he replied, he said, if things continue as they are, he will be the mayor next year. So there you go. Second order member mayor. The other one is in somewhere on the south coast, I think Hastings or somewhere down there. Who's also an order member, who's a town mayor. So this is Lokabandhu's second carbon sadhana based on flying.
This is Lokabandhu speaking from my hometown in Glastonbury, UK, and offering a guided meditation to everyone attending the third Tri-Ratna Earth Sangha online conference. This is one of two meditations I'd like to offer, and it's based upon a traditional Buddhist sadhana, helping us basically visualize some of the consequences of our actions, particularly flying. It might be a little sobering, but I'm hoping it will at least help raise awareness and kind of bring things to life in a way that dry scientific facts and figures maybe never will. So if you'd like to take part, you're really welcome. Take a minute or two to prepare yourself for a normal meditation, making sure you're sitting somewhere comfortable, quiet. Maybe you've lit a shrine, a candle on the shrine. Close the door, switched off your phone, and here we are preparing to meditate. As always, taking a minute or two again to tune in to yourself, your body, letting go of any aches, pains, tensions, and so on. Also, letting your weight drop down through your body. Being supported by the earth underneath us. getting a sense at the same time as your weight drops down, of your energy, as it were, rising up, tuning into yourself physically. Also, becoming aware of what kind of emotions might be in your mind, just noting them. Letting go of them so they don't blow you away in any sense during the meditation. And also any thoughts in your mind. Again, easier said than done. But just noting them and then letting go of them. Traditional analogy is looking at them, being aware of them, like clouds in the sky, trusting that they will move on in their own time. So, once we've prepared our space, tuned into ourselves physically, emotionally, mentally, getting a sense of ourselves seated in the midst of an infinite clear blue sky. A very beautiful and traditional beginning to any Buddhist visualization practice. The blue sky stretches out in all directions from where we are. Without limit, pure, sparkling, blue, infinite. Kind of pure, open energy. We too are not different from the blue sky. Now, high in the sky, we see a cloud in the shape of a rainbow, a vast rainbow stretching hundreds, if not thousands of miles from west to east. A beautiful, enormous, sparkling rainbow cloud. cloud has this rainbow shimmer to it. It's mostly white, like most clouds are. But as we look at it, take our awareness to it in a little more detail, we notice it has a faint brownish edge. Becoming aware of the cloud in a bit more detail, we see at the western end of the cloud, far in the distance, a tiny aeroplane moving towards us. As we draw closer to this aeroplane, in our mind's eye, we peer inside it, and among all the passengers, we see one person, and we realize this is a member of the Triratna Buddhist community, even the Triratna Buddhist order. An individual, maybe a friend of ours, maybe not, but a fellow Buddhist. Their eyes are closed, sitting in their seat in this aeroplane, and they're meditating. In fact, they are happy and at peace because they are going on pilgrimage from the west to the land of the Buddha, where they will be circumambulating the holy places of Buddha. Now, a little bit of time passes. We see again the order member, or the member of our community, no longer in the aeroplane. They've arrived. They are, in fact, part of the crowds at the Mahabodhi temple, at the Bodhi tree in Buddha Gaya, Bihar, India. Along with all the other faithful pilgrims, they are walking, they are circumambulating, they're making prostrations, they're doing puja. Again, happy and inspired as they fulfill their life's dream of pilgrimage to one of the holy places of Buddha. Rainbow light shines out in all directions. Perhaps we've been there ourselves, perhaps we too aspire to visit the holy places of Buddha, making pilgrimage ourselves. Now, as we contemplate this member of our community, we realize above their head is a strange shape, almost invisible, a little bit like the rainbow cloud, but nevertheless perceptible and in fact real. What it is, it's an enormous envelope, a balloon of gas, kind of floating above their head, way up in the sky, in the shape, maybe, of a hot air balloon. It's got almost no colour, no sound, smell, taste, touch, almost nothing for the mind to take hold of. Yet there it is. It floats above their head, following them as they circumambulate, as they sit to meditate, as they do their prostrations. It's enormous, far bigger than they are. In fact, it is the size, approximately, of an international football stadium. in the balloon, in this almost invisible hot air balloon shaped bubble envelope, we realize it's simply air. But not quite normal air, it's air with double the standard volume, the normal concentration of carbon dioxide. It looks the same, colourless, odourless, invisible, but we reflect that if all air had this concentration of carbon dioxide, 800 parts per million CO2 rather than the present 400, life on Earth as we know it would effectively be annihilated. We reflect further that the balloon and the air above it are not really there. In fact, they were admitted by the aeroplane during the pilgrim's journey, and they exist in reality somewhere way up in the atmosphere, high in the blue sky. The balloon, the international football stadium size balloon, appears to exist only above their head as they perform their prostrations and pilgrimage, simply to symbolize the karmic connection between their actions and the consequences. So, taking a minute or two, simply to reflect on the benefits of pilgrimage, the joy of visiting the holy places and feeling in touch with the Buddha and his teaching, and all that has come from that, and yet at the same time reflecting on the reality of the carbon dioxide which has been emitted, even though it has no colour, sound, smell, taste or touch. Nevertheless, there it is, an international football-sized stadium of air high in the atmosphere. Now again, a little bit of time passes, and we tune in again to the clear blue sky. The radiant, infinite, clear blue sky, stretching in all directions. Once again, we become aware of a vast rainbow-coloured cloud, stretching across the sky. This time, however, not from west to east, but east to west. Once again we see it is white with a very faint brownish edge. Once again we see somewhere along its length is a tiny aeroplane traversing the sky along the path of the rainbow cloud. Once again, we see inside the aeroplane, along with all the other passengers, a member of our community, perhaps even a member of the order. Again, they're meditating, they're happy, inspired, full of gratitude for having been able to make their pilgrimage, their cherished lifetime's goal of visiting the holy places of the Buddha. But once again, we see there is a consequence. Now, a little bit of time passes. We see our individual back home, returned safely from their pilgrimage, full of stories, full of memories, photographs, full of faith. Maybe speaking to their friends, maybe encouraging others to perform pilgrimage in the same way. Maybe giving talks at the Buddhist Center. But again, above their head, we see a second hot air balloon shaped envelope, almost invisible, but nevertheless kind of shimmering in the blue sky. Again, it's the size of an international football stadium, and again it contains carbon dioxide at twice the current volume of CO2. We realize there's not one, but two of these envelopes of gas. One has remained in India, in Bodh Gaya. One has returned back to the person's home. We see our individual becoming aware of the need to offset their emissions, and we see them planting trees, maybe themselves in a field, in a wood near where they live, or maybe funding others to do it. They realize the need to offset their emissions, and they're planting trees. Very slowly. Perhaps now time speeds up a little bit and we realize not merely a day, but a week, a month, a year has passed. The trees are growing, but very slowly. Maybe 10 years has passed. Even 50 years. It takes this long for the trees to trap and absorb the amount of carbon dioxide in the two football-sized stadiums of gas. finally, we realize our Buddhist who's been on pilgrimage is not alone. They are but one of many, many, many individuals who have traversed the rainbow-coloured cloud from east to west and west to east, fulfilling perhaps a lifetime's goal of pilgrimage to the India, or even a lifetime's goal of visiting our Buddhist centres in the West. We realise above the head of each one is not one but two envelopes, balloons of almost invisible gas, air containing double the present concentration of carbon dioxide, and the size of an international football stadium. We see all these balloons kind of side by side, merging with each other, hovering in high in the atmosphere, and persisting, not a week, not a year, not even a decade, but perhaps 40 or 50 years, until very slowly the carbon dioxide is once again absorbed into the elements. Finally, bringing to mind the Buddha, we remember some of his many epithets, and one of them is the Akirika. The Buddha was known as Akirika, the trackless one, who walked without leaving a footprint, was able to pass through the world without leaving traces. We aspire to follow the Buddha's example. So, ending the meditation by coming back to ourselves, sitting quietly, peacefully, following our breath, breathing in, breathing out. Allowing ourselves to be aware of the images from the meditation. Also allowing ourselves to be aware of any thoughts or feelings arising from the meditation. Not in a rushed or judgmental way, just allowing them to come up and be held in our awareness, to be acted on at leisure in whatever way we choose. Finally, perhaps bringing to mind one of the great aphorisms of our teacher, Bhante Sangharakshita, that awareness is revolutionary. Awareness is revolutionary. And with this, in our own time, but without any hurry, ending the meditation.
So when you're ready, opening your eyes, looking around, taking in the other people on the screen. And I can imagine that meditation has been brought up different things for you, different thoughts, different feelings. So if there's something you'd like to write in the chat, any comment or reflection, we'll have a couple of minutes for that now, and then we'll close. Thank you for the comments. One says, at the end, I was reminded of the mind training to not judge others, but to look to my own unskillful actions. Another one, to become trackless would be a beautiful thing. And another one, sobering, a bit jarring in a good way. Yeah, a bit kind of shake. Kind of shakes you up a bit, doesn't it? Yeah, it shook me up a bit. Another one says, a good visualization of my actions, not traceless. Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? How we kind of, well, I'll speak for myself. How it's like, I'm aware of some of the consequences of my actions, but I don't really. It's like there's a kind of pushing away. There's a bit of pushing away. I'm like, no, that, no. Yeah, not really wanting to embrace fully the consequences of my actions. Yeah, that's what came up for me. Okay, folks, thanks very much for those comments. So next session with Gunakatu, who I see is already here. Sitting outside in the with the fire to keep him warm. So that will start in 23 minutes. So you can stay on here. We'll put you in the waiting room, or you can pop out and come back in 23 minutes time. And there's the Dana appeal in the chat if you'd like to contribute to the Buddhist Center Online and the Trio Nurse Sangha. Okay, see you in 23 minutes. Bye now.